Now I want to give quite a long example, which will relate important sampling with exponential tilting, with actuarial science, and large deviation results. We'll look at a classical model for an insurer. They have a reserve which increases at a constant rate P by collecting premiums over time. Claims arrive according to a Poisson process, and the claim sizes are IID distributed. Here I've set them to be exponential to make life simple, although this will work for any light-tailed distribution, I believe. What we want to do is calculate infinite time ruin probabilities. It turns out to be easier to work with the net payout process, which is the sum of the claims subtract away the income received. And so the only time that we can have ruin is at the one of the times when a claim arrives. We'll rewrite the arrival times of the claims as their inter-arrival times, psi I, and these will be exponentially distributed because they arrive according to a Poisson process. Now, the net payout calculated at each of these arrival times will give it the notation Sn because it can be written as a cumulative sum of these xi's, where each xi is the size of the new claim, and we take away how much premium we've earned in the time since the previous claim. Because a constant times an exponential variable is also distributed as an exponential variable, we'll rewrite this p psi as just vi with the new rate parameter, which simplifies our running sum to be Sn is a cumulative sum of the xi's, and each xi is ui subtract vi, two independent exponentially distributed variables. Given that we're starting with initial capital of small u, then the time of ruin, tau u, is the first time that our running sum of net payouts exceeds the initial capital that we have. Thus, the infinite time ruin probability is the probability the stopping time is finite. We can't use a traditional crude Monte Carlo to estimate this probability because the code might be in a scenario which doesn't have ruin, and so we might keep simulating this process forever. What we can do is just simulate the processes up to some finite time and use this as a rough lower bound for the infinite time ruin probability. Here I create a random number generator, pull in the constants that we'll use for this problem, specify a give up time, which is the number of claims to simulate before we declare that any scenario which has not hit bankruptcy will never hit bankruptcy, and capital R, the number of replications to simulate. We'll create a vector of alive which tracks each of the R replications to see whether they have not hit ruin yet, and Sn will be the running sum for each of the replications. We'll run our simulation claim by claim. We start by simulating the UNs, the VNs, and the XNs, which is simply the difference, and adding that to our cumulative sum, the SN. We look at whether or not bankruptcy has just occurred by calculating the vector of true or false for whether or not the cumulative sum has exceeded our threshold of U. We only want to consider those replications which haven't already hit bankruptcy in the past. So we take the AND operation with the alive vector. Next, we update the alive vector to reflect those newly bankrupted insurers are no longer alive. And if there are none left, then we can stop simulating new claims and return our answer. Otherwise, we get to the end of our computational budget and look at the fraction which have not survived, and we use that as our lower bound estimate for the infinite time room probability. This took almost 7 seconds to simulate, and our estimate for ruin is lower bound of 3 by 10 to the 6. We'll use input and sampling in order to see the event of interest, the ruin, happen more frequently. Instead of simulating from the distribution F, we'll say that the X's are distributed according to a proposal of G, which is the exponentially tilted form of F. Here I give the denotation for the moment generating function M and the cumulant generating function kappa. If we simulate according to G all of the X's until we hit ruin, then the likelihood ratio is the product of each of the X's individual likelihood ratios. And because we have taken this nice form of proposal, that is, we have taken exponentially tilted variables, the likelihood ratio has a quite pleasant form. Finally, we can say that our estimate for the infinite time ruin probability is this sum, where we have the indicator whether or not the event happened multiplied by the likelihood ratio. We only want to use important sampling to increase the likelihood of the rare event happening. To see whether we achieve this or not, let's look at the mean of the X variables under the proposal distribution. The mean of X under G can be converted into a mean under F using this exact same change of measure that we've been using all through important sampling, although it might look a bit weird because every other time we've been moving from F to G, but to go from G back into F, it works in the same way. Substituting in the specific form of G, which is the exponentially tilted version, we get the new mean under G in terms of a mean under F of X e to the theta X. This mean on the right is actually the derivative of the moment generating function. And the next line shows you the steps to get to this result. And we can simplify this even further by noting that the derivative of the cumulant generating function, that is just the derivative of the log of the moment generating function. Using the chain rule, we can see that that's exactly what we have on the right here. Therefore, our conclusion is the new mean of X under G is the derivative of kappa at theta. We should choose the exponential tilting parameter theta so that in the new distribution, the X's have a non-negative mean. In that scenario, the running sum will trend upwards, and so the probability that we'll hit the threshold of U in some finite time is going to be 1. This solves the problem where crude Monte Carlo may have taken infinitely long to finish some scenario generation. So for our specific case, what does this M moment generating function look like? Remember, our sum ends are the difference of independent exponential random variables. If you look at any exponential random variable E with rate lambda, it has a moment generating function of lambda on lambda subtract theta. Doing some algebra, we can see that the moment generating function of the difference is the moment generating function of U evaluated at theta multiplied by the moment generating function of V evaluated at minus theta. And we get the particularly simple form on the bottom right. We haven't actually decided yet which specific proposal distribution we're going to use because we haven't chosen what the tilting parameter should be. If we tilt in such a way that the cumulant generating function has a derivative which is positive at theta, then this will allow us to ensure that the ruin occurs with probability 1. In that case, the important sampling estimator simplifies because this indicator can disappear. If we choose the theta very carefully, then we can have the other simplification that occurs here, which is the last term in the exponential disappearing. That's when we choose theta to satisfy kappa theta equals 0. This corresponds to solving for the moment generating function taking a value of 1, and we'll say that happens at the value of gamma. Solving this, we find that gamma is lambda u subtract lambda v. Now that we've chosen a specific proposal distribution, we need to be able to simulate from it. The proposal distribution g has a quite simple density, that is e to the gamma x times the original density f. We'll use that information to calculate the moment generating function of the proposal distribution. The goal here is to hope that we can recognize the moment generating function as some simple distribution that we know how to simulate from. We start with the definition of G's moment generating function, substitute in the fact that G is the exponentially tilted form of F, combine the exponential terms, and we get that the moment generating function of x under g is the moment generating function of f of x under f, which has just been shifted by a plus gamma. Expanding this further and simplifying again, we can see that the moment generating function is the difference of exponential random variables, the same kind of distribution we started with, except the parameters are slightly different now. To simulate for x underneath the measure g, we will simulate x as a difference of exponentials, but the u will now be distributed according to an exponential with parameter lambda v, and the v take the parameter lambda u. So the code here is quite similar to what we had before. Start off with a random number generator, calculate this tilting parameter gamma. We will still tell Python to stop simulating after a certain number of claims, because this is just general good practice to avoid writing while loops that may run forever due to some small programming bug. I'll have alive be the vector of true or false, which will keep track of which of the R simulations hasn't hit bankruptcy yet. Sn will be identical to before, and LRs will be the likelihood ratio for each of the estimates. Going claim by claim, we simulate u and v, now using the parameters which have been switched. Sn is updated the same as before. We pull out those replications which go bankrupt at this specific claim. And for those, we store the likelihood ratio, which is e to the minus gamma, and the value of the sum at this point. We record that the scenarios which go bankrupt in this iteration won't be alive in future iterations, and check that if all of our scenarios have become bankrupt, we quit the loop. If everything goes well, we expect that none will be alive by the time the loop ends. And just in case I gave up too early and some simulations needed a few more claims to go bankrupt, I have this small check here and a print statement. The estimates are now simply the likelihood ratios, and the mean and confidence interval calculations are the same as before. Let's run this now. Firstly, the time that it took to run this important sampling scheme is much less than the crude Monte Carlo. That took about 6 or 7 seconds. This one is in milliseconds. As we expected, the estimate for the infinite ruin here, which is about 4 by 10 to the minus 6, is larger than our lower bound that we calculated by crude Monte Carlo, which was 3 by 10 to the minus 6. Here our confidence interval is quite small, on the order of 10 to the minus 7, and overall found quite a satisfying way to solve this problem. I'll probably give you some more information about the link to large deviations in the next lecture, or maybe give you an assignment question on this next in our next class. That's all for now. Goodbye.